Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Ask Commissioner Manning if they will give their invocation.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are once again grateful for the opportunity to meet, do the work of this county. We ask for your guidance as we discuss the matters before our county. We ask that you watch over those that are currently serving away from this country but for this country. We ask that you bless the citizens that are here tonight, the Alamance County staff, and the Board of Commissioners as we begin our work tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
At this time, I will begin the public comment section. And I do want, before I do that, I want to read the, if you've never read this, I would like for everybody to read it before it will be posted on the window. It was out there. This is our policy that we adopted for the public comment section. And I want to read the first one. The public comment period shall be held in the beginning of each regular monthly commissioners meeting. The comment period shall be limited to a maximum of 30 minutes. Because subjects of special and emergency meetings are often regulated by law, there will be no public comment period reserved on agendas of special and emergency meetings. However, like regular monthly meetings, these commissioners' response period, these meetings are open for public attendance. The Alamance County Board of Commissioners shall have a commissioner's response period immediately following the public comment period for follow-up or addressing issues that arise from the public comment section. This shall be a point of response from commissioners to respond to comments that have been made and not debates with the public. Just wanted everybody to know that very first one and clear up any thing that people did not understand. So at this time, I'm going to open the public comments with Mike Curley.
Kelly.
Sorry.
That's printing, actually, if you can believe it. Good evening, Commissioner. Good to see you.
Good evening.
I just want to take a brief moment or two tonight to ask you to consider reversing to earlier plan that you had on the O&E sale or transfer, whichever this is turning out to be. You had originally scheduled a public comments period, public hearing. And I noticed that last meeting that somehow morphed into a resolution. And thank you, Mr. Manning, for furthering that on, giving us another chance to review this. I'd like at some point in time to have an opportunity for anyone in the public to come forward and have comments on this, because we're looking at a property that is on record in the Register of Deeds office as $1.1 million purchase by this county for vocational trades some time ago. And that's in 1988 dollars. I know it's on the books now for considerably less, and I'm not sure why, and I'd really like to cover that also. I spoke briefly with a couple of commissioners earlier, and I'm hoping that you guys will have some comments on this, and maybe we can get some public input rather than this thing just shuffling on down the road. I understand that it was deliberate in its orientation in the May 2nd meeting when it was floated to the commissioners, because the temperature and the air conditioner was a big issue, but time has ticked away, and that issue is growing dimmer and dimmer. And so I'm not really certain why we need to sell this property at this time, especially with the market values such as they are. Thank you for your time, and hopefully we can discuss this further another time.
All right. Thank you. Okay, next is Margaret Dameron.
My friend and I have changed our mind. We're going to wait for the next meeting.
Okay, I'll mark you off. Thank you. Eddie Shue.
Good evening, Madam Chair, Commissioners. I'm kind of going to repeat what he said. I wanted to talk on three issues, but this time thing and all these rules, you better have to kind of pick what you want to say. But that looks like a targeted sale over there to me. And if it's going to be so, I think if it were in some trade magazines, you know, put out there some way, so we would probably get better bids. And this seems like what this rush that it is to get these people a deed to it. And I don't think that selling it in the manner it appears to me to be going to be sold with best interest of taxpayers. That's pretty good property. Even I think it ought to be considered if they really see, if it wasn't a targeted sale, then when you want these people to stay in it, they would be in the count. It looked like if it was actually to take care of taxpayers, you would fix the thing, get the most you could out of it. But of course, if you fix the thing, you'd still have those people in it. I understand your position, but y'all's job is kind of look out to us, because we say out here we're not supposed to know all this stuff. All we can do is read the agenda, listen to what y'all say, and scratch your head and say, this don't seem right. And I'm saying, you know, I think county could do better if we're going to sell the thing. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, that's the last of this. You guys have any comments at this time? That was the last person to speak. It is going to be discussed by Mr. Albright tonight, so that maybe will give somebody some more information about it. So he is on our agenda for that. Any other comments from the commissioners? Anybody? All right, we'll move to number five, which is the Sheriff's Department Budget Amendment number 7.
Good evening, Commissioners. It's great to appear before you tonight. I'm asking the Commissioners to allow me to transfer $30,000 from our state drug seize monies into an automobile line item to purchase one more vehicle, which technically is a 2012 police package Chevrolet Caprice, but it actually shows as a 2011 because it's a test car that Dick Shirley has got in, and all the agencies in the county has driven it, and we want to purchase it. And to use state vice money where we took, you know, through the state treasury to buy this vehicle with. It will cost us $24,800. We did the bid process, et cetera. That's been turned over to our purchasing agent. And the remaining money will go for blue lights and stuff for the vehicle.
Are we getting computers in all these cars we're buying?
Yeah, well, we've got them in Sun. The county has taken care of some of them, but I'm getting ready to purchase 12 more. I want to make sure the right computer, because we have had some problems with the maintenance or the way the computers are hooked up in our car, and we're looking to buy 12 more. That will also, I'll appear before you, ask that be taken out of federal drug seize monies, along with some cameras, in-car cameras. You will not believe how a camera can help you on internal investigations and the number of hours you have to put. Pictures do not lie. Yeah. And with the situation here in Alamance County, we're going to need those cameras with the what's going on.
Yeah. Any more questions? I'll entertain a motion at this time.
So moved.
Have a motion.
Second.
And second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed. Thank you. Okay, next is the presentation online inspections, Mr. Strobridge, who is our director of inspections. How are you?
I'm well, thank you. Good evening, Commissioners. Let's see if I can get this to, oops, it was already up. The purpose for my presentation this evening is really twofold. First, to provide you with some information about the latest program we are about to launch. And secondly, to get your approval on a process that's needed in order to maintain our identity verification requirement. And we'll get to all that in a minute, but first I'd like to bring you up to speed as to what brings us to this point. As you know, we're constantly trying to improve our processes and efficiencies within the department, and one proven way to do so is through the use of technology. About 3 years ago, our MIS department installed the new central permitting computer software that we are currently using and sharing with the Environmental Health Department and the Planning Department. It's more user-friendly than our previous software and provides for easier data collection and retrieval and offers more reporting options. It's also fast, versatile, and as you'll see in a moment, expandable.
Can everybody hear? Can we get
that mic?
The mic might be a little
bit. Yeah, it could be the mic.
Shall I stand a little closer?
No. You just about to speak up.
Okay.
Use your hollering.
This comes up from time to time. Nothing is amplified in this room. It's just acoustic. So if you can't hear me, we just need to talk louder.
I'll talk louder.
It's amplified if you play back the video.
Thank you, Mr. President.
I apologize. Soon after this new software was up and running smoothly, we made the move to eliminate monthly billing and provide customers with options to use credit cards in person or over the phone to pay any and all fees collected by the department. And this has been proven to be a great success. We've got a lot of compliments about that. Next, we replaced the desktop computers that the inspectors were using with laptop computers that they could take into the field. This enabled them to capture and take the same data that was in central permitting into the field for their use. It gave them access to permit and inspection information that they used to have to call that they used to have to call back to the office to get. It was good but limiting because the data had to be resynced with our servers or computer at the end of the day or the next morning. They weren't talking to one another. So the next step, we expanded their capabilities by providing them direct access to the database via wireless connection so they can interface with our database in real time. The benefits of this is the inspectors in the field, when they result inspections, enter it into their laptop, it goes directly into our database, and it is available for anyone to know at that time. And this brings us to where we are today. The next logical step is a further expansion of our capabilities by providing limited access to our database for public use. Information will now be available to anyone with internet access 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Two functions will be provided: a view only for the general public, where there's no security needed. In other words, anyone will be able to punch in an address or a permit number if they know it and see all permit and inspection information at that address and the history that goes along with it. Secondly, we're going to offer enhanced interaction for contractors' use. Contractors will now be able to obtain permits online, schedule and cancel inspections, pay fees, all from their home computer or office computer. But in order to do this, they'll have to create an online account with us. And I'll get to the details of that in a second. And again, permit purchases will be initially limited to 5 types of permits. First is HVAC changeouts, mechanical HVAC changeouts, electrical service changes, water heater changeouts, plumbing, and water heater changeouts, electrical. We chose these 5 types of permits because we refer to them as administrative permits. They require no further review of any kind, either from our department, environmental health, planning, any other agency. They're just kind of step up to the counter, pay your fee, fill out the form, and you get your permit. Very easy permits to handle online. This brings me back to the other purpose of the presentation. As you know, the county now requires anyone that obtains a permit to show a valid ID, including a picture ID. That's going to be hard to do online. So to maintain that identity verification, we're going to ask contractors to come into the office, physically come in back into the office, show their photo ID, we'll collect all their data, we will issue them a user ID plus a password, like you would for any other online account, your bank, any place else you do online business. And that'll be captured within our database, and we'll have that information. Then that contractor, anytime he wants to use the system to either purchase permits or any of those functions we talked about, requesting inspections or paying fees, he just uses that account and makes those things happen. Now, once an account has been established, contractors can, again, do several things. And I have a series of PowerPoint slides here. I'm just going to go through briefly. I don't want to bore you with all the minutiae here. But once a permitting technician creates the account and provides with a ID and valid email address, the contractor will also receive a printout with instructions on how to use the system that will also be printed or available online on the screen for anyone to use. And these accounts will stay active indefinitely unless there's no activity within a three-year period. This is primarily for maybe out-of-state contractors or contractors that are not from this area, maybe here for a one-time or one- or two-time project and then go away. If we don't see any additional activity in 3 years, we're going to void that that account. And if he wants to reestablish it, he'll have to come in and go over the system again. Okay, so how do we purchase a trade permit online after your account has been created? You visit the inspections department's website. As you can see here, you log in. There's information on our screen telling you how to use the site. You enter your login information, once again, your username and your password. Log in. It gives you several options here. This option is going to, you're going to click on request a permit if you want to obtain a permit. Select what type of permit you're looking for. In this case, it's a HVAC changeout, mechanical. Next screen, you'll provide the address information. And here they have West Elm. If you don't know the street number and you click on the West Elm, you'll get a series of addresses to look at. Pick the one that is appropriate to your needs. Select that address. That'll be filled in. Then you go about filling out the rest of the application, very similar to our paper application that we have now, except it'll be filled out online. Submit the application. It'll go back to our office where it will be reviewed, and then our fees will be calculated for that permit, and a permit technician will then email the applicant back, letting them know that the application has been approved and what fees were involved. Then the applicant will go back online using their ID, click My Activity, where you'll be able to do a number of things, and including make the payments for the permit. There we go. From this screen, the information about the permit is revealed. You'll be able to view what inspections have been made or select new inspections and request inspections at any time. This is an example of a screen. You'll see that what inspections have been made, the inspection type, the date that was requested, the inspection date, who the inspector was, and the status, whether it was passed or rejected. If it was rejected, you have the option to click on View Notes, and once you do that, the code violations will be shown at the bottom of the screen, so you'll know just why it was rejected. And again, for permit search, type in your street number or address. You can click Permit Search for one particular address and see all the permits that were associated with that address that comes up on the screen. So in summary, the service will be able to allow folks to access our database 24 hours a day, 7 days a week online. Contractor accounts are going to be available for anyone who wants them. Security includes the identification check with the ID and the password. Initially, the five permits will be available. Administrative permits will be available first. We hope to expand that in the future. And then we're going to start to implement this early in the fall, hopefully October or sooner. Any questions?
Any questions?
And sounds like you got it covered.
Bob, only.
Yes, sir.
I know we talked about this in the past about bringing Central, the environmental in somehow with you guys. Is that ever going to happen?
We are looking at that as we speak.
That's really an inconvenience because when you got to go get a
permit,
then you got to come back over here and you end up doing a run.
There are some issues with the Environmental Health Department that we're trying to overcome to make that happen. We are working on that really as we speak. We've had some meetings recently with them, and we're going to have some follow-up meetings in the next couple of weeks.
It'd be really great.
Okay.
Builders, I know if you could.
Yeah, we're going to try very hard to make that work.
Yeah.
You think the builder's going to appreciate this?
Oh, yeah.
I think so.
I mean, once you get it going and get it, the kinks ironed out, hopefully you can expand into the other permits.
Yeah.
You may have missed it. But what do you, how do you verify that somebody's got a general contractor's license online like this? I mean, are they showing it to you, or emailing it to you, or what?
If they give us their name and their general contractor number, we verify that online with the licensing board.
So
for every permit that's issued, every contractor's number is verified.
Yeah.
Now, the state has passed an e-verify law. If I'm not mistaken, it's been passed. Is that correct? It's going to be phased in. Do we have e-verify at all addressed with this process here?
I am not familiar with that at all.
You don't know what e-verify is?
No, sir.
We have it identified with driver's license that they had to permit or submit a valid picture ID with it. So if it's not,
that's not e-verified.
No, it's not e-verified.
He's not going to do e-verified.
Why are we not incorporating that?
There was some reason at the time we didn't. I think this was the closest compromise we could do.
Compromise with who?
And is moving the process forward of getting some type of picture ID.
Well, they're a dime a dozen.
Well, Tim, if you go in there, they don't do e-verify if you walk in and say, here's...
Well, I know. I'm just saying, Can we not start it here legally?
I don't know.
The state
if
has
it's
passed
a state
law,
we can do it.
If the state has passed a law that after you have X amount of employees, that every business, state of North Carolina, doing business in the state, not just with state, with government entities. E-verify is where you verify the citizenship, whether it's legitimate or not, federal government, Homeland Security.
So, well, if the state is verifying it to get a license, would that not catch it?
Well, I'm talking about the state has passed a law that says that everybody can require anybody doing business in the state of North Carolina, not just with government entities, but just doing business, period, which I would assume would be, you know, same, you know, us giving permit to somebody to do business in our county, that they would have to show after they have a certain amount of employees that they use e-verify, and they have to sign a statement saying they use e-verify or something. I don't know the ins and outs of the law, but it's on the books.
Hmm. I guess we'll look into that.
I would think we should, yeah.
Any other questions?
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, one thing we do have to, the three-year period, there needs to be a vote by the board about the three-year period.
Okay.
Does there?
What, to implement this?
Yeah, well, to keep the information valid for the contractors for a three-year period.
Okay.
I think that's a change of what we have now, isn't it?
Okay. No, well, there's something. 7 years on what? You can go back and check permits quite a ways back.
The way it was now is everybody was having to come into the office, and the board here a while back had wanted them, every time they come in, to present identification to the inspections department to verify who they were. The problem is, when we implement this program, what we were hoping to do is when they come in at one time, that presentation of documentation is good for a three-year period of time. At the end of that three-year period of time, they'll have to come back in again and re-up, so that they won't be, that's the only way this program can work, so that they're not having to come in.
Right.
If you're going to make it online, they've got to be able to come in one time within a three-year period of time.
But I still hope that we would try to be as full as we can be on this. As my understanding, Guilford County uses E-Verify in granting permits in Guilford County. That's what I've been told.
Well, what if a homeowner come in and wanted a permit?
Well, you know, that's taking it down to the minimal number of employees, right?
Could actually some homeowners come in and do their own stuff?
Yeah, but they can't do it online. I mean, just
well, I know they couldn't do it online, but I'm just saying they can go in the inspection though and get a permit.
Check in, if you don't mind. I would ask that you look into Guilford County and see what they're doing on the e-verify portion of this.
We'll look into it
and then see if we can incorporate it to some degree, even if they're not.
So we need a motion.
There'll be a motion because since we are doing it online and not requiring them to come in every time,
I'll make the motion.
That it's a three-year period.
A motion.
Second.
Second. Yeah. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next is a presentation from Performance Management and Performance-Based Budgeting. Nope, sorry. Tax business. Mr. York, I about skipped right on over you there. I checked you off already. And I want to thank him. They've really done a great job at 98.7, I think it is, if I'm not mistaken, of tax collection. So that's a great record, I think. So, but we want the rest of it too.
Okay. Good evening. I'm here to present the annual settlement statement for tax year 2010. Before I get started with the numbers, I'd like to present two members of my staff that I appointed last January. They've done a fantastic job. Emily Moon is our collections manager, and Jeremy Atkins is our systems administrator.
And Jeremy?
They've done an excellent job.
Thank you.
Now to the numbers. Okay, these numbers are just the general fund. This does not include our total levy that we'll collect. The general fund, the 2010 levy, $62,961,585.47. Of that amount, we have collected $61,259,151.79. Our collection rate is up 0.62% from last year. Our real and personal rate is up 0.5%. Our motor vehicle rate is up 0.29%. Again, the motor vehicles are a problem. We're at about 87.85 on the motor vehicles. We have started levying on vehicles in November with the aid of the Sheriff's Department. We've collected about $58,000 since November by levying vehicles, which is a substantial number that we would not have collected otherwise, in my opinion. Our uncollected amount for tax year 2010 is $1,702,433.68. Total enforced collections for the year, $3,919,979. During the past year, we have performed 7,241 garnishments. Special interest there, as of the day, the amount for garnishments has doubled to $60. The fee has been $30. As of today, the state law has changed to $60 on garnishments. So that will be a significant amount of fees for the county to collect. We referred 96 cases for foreclosure in the past year. Collected $160,271 through debt set off, which is tax refunds, lottery winnings. And staff has completed 182 rent attachments. Referring back to last year on June the 30th, our outstanding levy was $2,097,428. We have now collected $1.6 million of that. So we are now at 99.23% of collections for 2009, and I think we'll wind up collecting all but maybe 0.2% of that. So, our staff is doing a great job, and I applaud them for that, and I'm sure you do. Any questions on the settlement report? I would add that we've collected about an additional $8 million for the four municipalities that we collect for, and also on registered motor vehicles. Okay.
Thank you.
Second order of business is the charge off of 2001 property taxes. As of June the 30th, the balance on the 2001 taxes, $83,774.50. As of August the 31st, we are not allowed to take collection action on that. We have a 10-year statute of limitations on collections. We have turned a number of these accounts over to ICC Datamax. They are still collecting. We can continue to collect after September the 1st. We just can't initiate action. So we have now initiated all the action we can. The $83,000 will go down before September the 1st, but after September 1st, we will not initiate any more actions on those. And I think our third order of business is for Ms. Massey to give us an order of tax collection for the coming year. Any questions?
Have I resigned it? I signed something before I got started. Well,
you're just going to take it.
But I'll sign this one for you, sir.
That's a good idea. I think that's a good idea. Take us all out to dinner.
Who, me or Gerald?
Yeah.
Any questions?
I can do that. Any questions from anybody? I think you've done a great job, Darrell.
Thank you.
And,
thank you.
Especially coming from what we had before.
Well, I do think we
and your staff.
We've improved credibility, I think, in the office, and we're proud of that. And I think everybody's on board knowing that we are public servants and we are doing our best to serve the public.
Okay. Well, and you're doing it in a professional, nice way. I mean, you're the tax collector.
Yes, sir.
And I've heard compliments of people that have come in here and had to deal with
you. And people who called and asked you questions, they have told me how responsive and supportive you've been.
Yeah. Appreciate that.
You want me to sign this one, or you got another one?
Oh, the original there.
Get on with the business.
Okay. Yes, sir. Okay, now, is that, you're done, aren't you? Okay, now we're going to go to the presentation of performance management and performance-based budgeting. Mr. Burgess.
Madam Chair, members of the board, good evening. Have a short presentation here, and also have the department heads that were involved in this process with us, too, to answer any questions you may have about their individual plans. Of course, from DSS, Susan Osborne, EMS, Chuck Mancellus, GIS, Bruce Walker, Maintenance, Richard Hill, Recreation Parks, Brian Haygood, Library, MJ Goodrun, and then also have Susan Roberts, who is taking kind of lead on this project and helping me out with this. So, and I want to thank all of them for participating. Most of them voluntarily participated, by the way. So I'm glad of that. And we appreciate all the work that they've put into it, and we look forward to seeing the improvements that actually take place in their departments over the next year and beyond that. What I want to talk to first is just talk about what performance budgeting, performance management, performance-based budgeting is, and then talk about our timeline for full implementation. We have started this project as of July the 1st, but it takes a while to fully implement this program, so we'll talk about that some. And then in your agenda packets are the goals for each of the departments, the way they're going to measure them and those things. Again, the department heads are here to answer any questions that you may have about their individual departments. So I'll get started. What is performance management? That is basically where a department looks within their department to see where they can improve with efficiency, productivity, and customer service. And then what they do is they set goals that will be measured over a year period of time, and to see to try to achieve those goals, which should improve in those one, two, or three of those areas within their departments. Again, looking to improve on the efficiency, the productivity, and the customer service, and or the customer service on a particular function within a department. If you look at most of the departments, they picked three, four, five, six areas, whatever they wanted to improve on. So that's really what the performance management piece is. Now, what is the performance-based budgeting? That is basically where, again, they set goals, and I'll just say a department decides that a certain function that they form normally takes them 36 hours to perform, and they want to get that done in a 24-hour period of time, and they want to make sure that when they perform that 90% of the time that they're within that. So they'll measure that for a year period of time. If they achieve that goal, then they get to the second part of this, which is the performance-based budgeting piece. Now, what the performance-based budgeting piece is that they will look in their budget, and they will try to find areas in which they can save money in their budget by cutting, by doing whatever, by maybe contracting things out, bringing things in-house, whatever they can do to save money. If they are able to save money, then we're going to have a monetary policy that says if they're able to save money, they'll get to keep a percentage of that savings if they met the goals that they had strived for. And so that's kind of how this performance management, performance-based budgeting works. So again, you take the performance management piece, which sets the goals, and if they achieve those goals and they experience savings in their budget, then they get to keep a percentage of that savings. The percentage of that savings goes to them, to their department, and then the remainder of that goes back into the counties, which we hope will go into the fund balance to be able to build the fund balance up or to be used for other items. So that's performance management, performance-based budgeting, and that's how those two relate to each other. Most of the time, the performance management goals that you set will not in themselves save money. The savings may come from things that are not related at all to the performance management goals. There could be some goals that do save you money, but as a general rule, the way ours are set up is that the savings will come from areas that are not related to the goals themselves. Now, the participating departments I mentioned earlier, DSS, EMS, GIS, maintenance, recreation and parks, and library. The training that the participants received, we had 11 staff members attend level one training at the School of Government. Four of those 11 staff members went on to the second level of training also so that they could have a better understanding of how this performance-based budgeting works. Talk to you a little bit about the timeline. On July the 1st, we did this year, the specific goals for performance management took effect and measuring began. So again, those goals that they set for their departments, they begin measuring those. They'll measure them throughout the whole budget year so that they can see whether the goals and the limits that they've set, whether they achieve those or not. July 1st through June 30th, all of the goals will be measured and tracked monthly, and a monthly reporting form will be completed by the department and sent to us. Then we'll actually do a quarterly report for the board members for y'all to see how people are, whether they're reaching their goals or not. This period will be used to assess the goals to make sure that they are at correct level. So for this whole period from July the 1st of this year to June 30th, all of the goals that they have set for themselves, we will just be we'll be looking at those not to reward them financially, but to see whether or not they are meeting those goals and see whether the goals were set correctly. For instance, if they set their goal that at 80% of the time they wanted to achieve this particular goal, if during this year we see that they're at 90%, then we know that that goal was not set correctly. We don't want to reward them financially this year because the goal was not set correctly. We may see that next year the goal needs to be set at 95%, so it's something they'll have to make some changes within their department to achieve that goal. That's basically what we'll be doing this year. Also, between July 1st and June 30th this year, we'll be setting a monetary policy, and the purpose of the monetary policy is to define what budgetary savings will qualify for the program. Just because a department head finds some savings within their budget doesn't necessarily mean that that will qualify where they'll get to keep a percentage of that savings. Second thing is also we'll define how the savings can be used. Just because they experience some savings, and those savings they are able to keep, it doesn't mean that they can spend that on just anything. That's a policy that we'll develop. Now, the process we're going to use for developing that policy is the group of participants will be involved in that process. Once we feel like we have a plan that we feel comfortable with, then we'll pass it by the county manager, make sure he approves it. Once we get his approval on it, then we'll bring it to the board for y'all to approve. So we'll do that sometime during this year. No monetary awards will be based on what the results are for this budget year. This, again, is for a period of time to make sure that their goals, that the goals they've set, that they're set at the correct levels. And then starting July 1st, 2012 through 2013, we'll revise the goals to make sure they're where they need to be, make sure they're not too easy to achieve, but yet not too hard to achieve. These will be measured and tracked, again, on a monthly basis, and then we'll report back to the commissioners on a quarterly basis with a report, so you'll see where everybody's tracking out at. And then on June 30th, 2013, the budgetary savings that are realized for that budget year then will be applied as per the monetary policy. Some will go back to the department. Some will come to the county as a whole. So that is kind of how the program in a nutshell works. And you do have in your agenda packet each of the six different departments' goals and their measurements, how they're going to measure it over the next year. And we will, again, be getting reports from the departments on a monthly basis. We'll report back to the board with a report on a quarterly basis for you to see how everybody's tracking out. Six departments to start with. We hope some more departments will get on in future years. I did check with Davidson County or looked at their report they had, and I think it was at the six-year period, they had like 14 departments that were involved in it. So we seem to be starting with six. I assume we're probably about where they were at the time. That's kind of how we're working.
You know, you and I went down to Davidson a couple of years ago, and looked at this. You know, Davidson County was nationally recognized for their success with performance-based budgeting. And they had been able to take at least $1 million a year, roughly, was my understanding, and move it into other departments and or general fund. And just one example, back when we were having the EMS debate about how many collectors that you would need if we did it in-house or broker it out, If we brokered it out in the comparison, you know, Davidson said they had two EMS collectors, where we were like, I think, showing that we were going to have four, but they had two, and now they had three. And I said, well, now how did you get the third one? How did you pay? He said, as a result of performance-based budgeting, that they were able to save the money enough to justify hiring another person. But how do you bridge the gap, the psychological human nature position that we don't get enough money as is, or we don't get, you know, the cost of operating our department is, you know, we're not getting all we want, you know, from the onset, we're not getting enough money. How did Davidson and Catawba, I think Davidson initially got their idea for performance-based budgeting in a government arena from Catawba, if I'm not mistaken. And, you know, my question is how do you bridge that psychological, you know, we can't do any better, or, you know, how do you well, how are we going to instruct them to go about that?
Yeah, I think the first part of it is the performance management, and you could do the performance management without a performance budgeting piece. You could just, with each of our departments, they could, and this is something that, and I think, and Brian Haygood could address this, and Brian's done tracking before with this stuff to see what satisfaction level that participants or users of maybe Cedar Rock Park would have. And so Brian's done some of this before we actually got started. So you could actually do this with departments without them participating in the financial part of it, where they set goals for their department and they want to improve in certain areas. And so they say we want 90% completion within 24 hours, whatever these goals are. Because a lot of times we're sitting there thinking that a department's not as productive as they need to be, but until we get some hard data on them and see where they actually are, and even see where they're maybe comparing with other counties, then we really don't know how productive or how efficient we are. And again, if we have a goal at 90% for something, and this year we're hitting 75%, then we know we've got a lot of changes to make to get that 90%. Now, the board can actually drive monetary, can drive fiscal policy using this program. For instance, if, and I'll just throw this out, but let's say that EMS, and I'll make an extreme case here so it'll make it that more obvious how this works, but let's say EMS had a 10-minute response time on all their calls, but the board says, you know, we're okay with an hour response time. So instead of having X number of employees, we can cut 70% of those employees out, and we would save $3 million, but our response time is going to be an hour. And I know y'all don't want to do that. Just as y'all could say that, and I'm not sure what the response time is, but just as y'all could say, okay, from a monetary standpoint, their response time is 10 minutes, but we want to get it down to 4 minutes, so therefore we're going to triple the number of ambulances they have on the road, and we're going to build a bunch of stations, so that's a monetary policy that the board could create and said, you know, we're willing to put millions of dollars more into EMS because we feel like our response time needs to be 4 minutes on every call. That, you know, so you can drive monetary policy by using the performance management and performance-based budgeting. Ours is not set up quite that way at this point, but reviewing the data each month and at the end of the year, if y'all see a department that you say, you know, that goal they've set, we would really, they're doing the best they can with the number of employees they've got, but we want to do better than that. Well, it may require putting money towards that department, or they may be getting a goal, and you may say, you know, we're okay with that goal being less, but we know that we're going to have to downsize their workforce because of that. So, I mean, monetary policy can be driven. That is a true performance-based budgeting program when you really use it in that format. What we're looking at more is to improve efficiency, productivity, and customer service. And then on the other side, the departments, that's their incentive to do this program is that if they can find savings within their budget, they're going to be able to take part of that savings and keep it for their department to buy things that they normally would not be able to buy for their department. Some counties have said, okay, whatever savings you get each year, you can roll it over up to 10 years so that you can build up a good-sized thing that you may be able to purchase a capital item that you normally wouldn't be able to get in your budget that may help your department out. Or are there other ways of spending that money? And that's something that we'll come back to you this next year and talk to you about.
Well, did you find in your talks to Davidson, and I, you know, personally asked that y'all call them, Catawba and Davidson, Did you find that there was any trend that county management was involved in telling a department, you know, this is what you need to do? Like private business does that, you know,
right,
all the time. They just don't leave it to the department right head to make up their own mind what they want to do. The CEO or the president or whatever branch manager will come out and say, you will do this. This is what we feel like you should be doing.
Right.
I mean, they got a more hands-on rather than just letting the department do it.
Right, and that's why we're using this first year to make sure that the goals are set where they need to be. We don't want them too low because then they're too easy to achieve. Mm-hmm. We also don't want them unreasonably high where there's no way that they can reach those goals either. So that's what we're working on over this next year period of time with us working with the department heads, Susan and myself, to make sure the goals are reasonable. Also, then when we get into the monetary part of it, is that's where finance will be even more heavily involved in it, because when we look at savings and all that, we've got to make sure that the baseline budget is set where it needs to be, so when we experience savings, that they're savings that they justifiably can keep in their departments. Now, one thing I will mention, and I did talk to Davidson County about this, because Davidson County was very successful in saving a lot of money as far as through this program. However, that was going back, I think they may have started in 2001 or 2002. Based on where our budget is now, based on all the cuts that have been made thus far, I don't know, departments are going to be striving for cuts, but I don't know, we're not going to see, and I even talked to the assistant county manager in Davidson County and ran our scenario by him and said, if y'all were starting your program now, would you have seen the savings that you experienced, you know, 8 years ago or whatever when they started, would you see those same savings now? And he agreed that he wouldn't because their budget is tighter now, just as ours is tighter than it was, you know, 8 years ago. Or, you know, so we don't want to think that we're going to come back with millions and millions of dollars worth of savings. We're going to work to make, you know, to make sure these savings happen, but they probably will not be at the level that Davidson County was because of the cuts in our budget over the last several years. Each of the department's budgets are tighter now than they were before.
I agree with that. Yeah.
And Tim, also, there, I think the department heads are fully aware that there's a commitment from this board and support for performance-based budgeting and management from the board. There is a strong commitment from county management that this is something we're going to implement. And again, as Tim said, we're looking at a lot of efficiencies. You know, we're working with DSS right now with the Lean program, trying to look at processes, how we can better do our jobs. And anytime we have positions that are left us, we freeze them, we see how we can allocate those positions and how we can do our job different. Everybody, I think, from a department head level knows that this is a new day. This is a different way to do things, and we are trying to do everything we can to try to be not do things the same old way. So we're, and again, I think Tim and Susan have done a wonderful job, and especially the department heads that have started with the program. So we'll at least see a lot of efficiencies and hopefully a lot better customer service as well.
Tim, I have a couple of things.
Yes, sir.
Based on the counties you looked at, Davidson, Catawba, whoever, do you know the percentage of the savings that went to the fund balance versus stayed in the department?
We'll have to look at it because we're going to need, as we get into the monetary policy part of this, we'll need to get their policy and look at it and see what percentages they used, and I do not know.
And the second
thing just based on memory from a long time ago, it seems like it was a most of the savings went back to the county, not to the department. But it was a hefty percentage.
I would think that would be appropriate because departments don't have fund balances.
Right.
So, I mean, if they have an allocated need, they should be submitting their needs to you anyway.
Right. But these would be items that normally they may not be able to get in their budget. However, there are needs that they have, but by them creating savings, and they can carry these savings over. It can be put into a capital account where they can carry it over from year to year until they build up a certain amount.
The second thing is, let's say they reach their goal and realize the savings, how frequently are the goals then reevaluated?
We can do that on a yearly basis. The goals would basically be set up for a year. So if they reach some goals and they've satisfied those, then they may need to drop that goal off the next year and incorporate a new goal. And this gets kind of complicated because what will probably happen is, let's say this first year they set 90% and they got 92% on it, you know, on that goal. So they need to drop that one off or either raise the goal the next year up to a 95. And make changes in their department. If they drop it off, they need to bring in a new goal. Well, that whole year for that next new goal will be a test year to see where the goal actually, the level ought to be set. And so this gets kind of complicated.
Well, more would be like on DSS first page, will not exceed 34% of subsidy cases. Well, you've got a lot of room there to improve if you're 34.
Yeah, and Susan maybe could address this, but we'll, and that's why we're, this year is just a monitoring year, really, to assess to see whether the goals are accurately set or not. That's why they're not going to get any monetary reward for this first year. It will be based on the second year because we hope that we tweak the goals to make sure they're set correctly.
I noticed that all of them had different formats.
That's correct.
Also, I mean, did you have a general format that they followed, or did you just...
They had to set their goals. Mm-hmm. And we were hoping to have similar spreadsheets,
right.
But when you look at the way their goals are and all that, it was simpler. I think it actually worked better for them to come up with their own spreadsheets how to track these.
Okay.
Basically, what they need to do is track it by the month, have their goal listed, track it by the month, whatever percentage their goal was, you know, as a percentage,
right.
They had to have that listed, and then whether they achieved the goal or not. So we try to have those similarities, but yes, they do look different by the month.
I just want to make a comment. I mean, it's good looking at saving money and all that, but I think the citizens of the county will really benefit from what I've read in these goals, and you know, because it's made everybody aware within each department of how do we serve the people that we serve better.
Right.
And
you know, and sometimes we, and like I said, I'll go back to Brian again, because Brian does a good job of surveying their participants and stuff like that. A lot of times we have an impression that this is what the public thinks of us, but until you get some hard numbers down there, you really don't know.
Right.
And you really don't know how well your program's working until you get some hard numbers and you can start comparing them with other counties, or, you know, whatever, or where, what our policy is as far as trying to reach a certain level of achievement or whatever. And so this gives you some hard data to work with. It's just not somebody's impression of how things are working.
I think that's good to have that feedback so that we as commissioners know, and management also. And I appreciate all the work you did on that.
And just want to make clarification, we're not trying to go to an hour response time on EMS. Right. Chuck and them do an excellent job much quicker than Ash. Don't want anybody to think
they
we're
do.
Trying to slow down that response
that's
time.
That's right.
So
thank you.
They do a good job.
Any more questions?
I want to ask one more. Do you know if in Davidson or Catawba whether there's any cash to as a salary to the department heads that get the results as a bonus?
There have been part of, and I'd have to go check, so I'm not sure where this occurred, but there have been a possibility of bonuses for the employees within a department if they reach certain goals. And that would be something that, you know, the monetary policy is going to come to the board. As it is, y'all are welcome to tweak it and change it and make whatever changes, and then y'all will need to approve it before we implement it. That could be one of the items. I don't know how the board feels about bonuses for the employees within a department. You know, there's pros and cons to that, but that would be something. Is that something that y'all would want us to consider as part of our monetary policy?
Private business does it all the time. That's what drives success. You got a manager that can kick it out of them and get the goals met and increase it, they get a bonus. And most of your employees realize that's what is driving a branch manager to snap the whip so hard, but you still want a job. So you perform, he gets the bonus. That's the way it works.
Well, let's do, if we can, on the bonuses, if we decide after we've met and have gone through it and the pros or the cons outweigh the pros or vice versa, we'll come back to y'all and let you know if we decide not to make it part of the policy, why we didn't. If we do decide, we'll let you know why.
Check with Davidson Catawba, because they really have laid the foundation, in my opinion, for this to be done in the state of North Carolina for government entities versus private business, because it's really unheard of in government versus the other side.
But we'll make sure when we come back for policy that we give you both sides on that issue.
Okay. Thank you, Ms. Burgess.
Okay. Got the next item also.
I think you're next.
Oh, yes, you
you're up again.
Okay. He is up again for discussion of relocating the commissioners' meetings to the Alamance County Historic Courthouse.
Okay. This is a follow-up to the meeting on June 20th. We were asked to bring back some financial information on the cost of relocating your meetings to the Historic Courthouse. The relocation of the camera equipment in here, it's not just the cameras, but it's some other equipment that's in the adjacent room, relocating that to the courthouse, plus running the cabling for that, tying it into the new AV system that's in the courthouse, which I thought it would be easier than it was, and I went up there and they explained to me what it would take, and it's quite comprehensive to do that, or complex, and that cost to doing that, and then there is some additional equipment that has to be bought. That was $20,706.24. That includes $20,706.24. So that includes turnkey for getting all of our existing equipment up there and getting it integrated with the new system. And then there was one piece of furniture that we need to buy to make this happen, and that was $2,622. So the total cost would be $23,328.24. If the board did choose to move forward with that, we do have some funds left over. We anticipate having some funds left over from the facility improvement plan, and that the funds could be paid out of that to if the board decided to make this move. So we would have money there.
Where is the sheet at again?
There it is. I see it. Okay.
Furniture. Cameras. Can the camera zoom in on that slide just like that for the TVs to be real clear?
In fact, the new AV system, the projector and the screen is, in fact, you can leave the windows open. It's a very nice system. You can actually leave the windows open, and it will still project on the screen where it's readable. Of course, I mean, it's that nice of a system up there, so it's a very nice audiovisual system
so
up there.
So you can zoom in, and you can get it just the way we're getting on our TV now, right?
Yeah. Now, that actually, what that part is what's up on the screen, and Kenny, correct me on this, what's up on the screen is actually done through the system. That's not actually from a projection. They're not actually videotaping the screen itself. That's actually done electronically through the system itself on all of the stuff that's put up on the screen. Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay. What about operationally as far as what it costs operationally to have our meetings here as far as personnel, air conditioning, heat, you know, shutting up the building, opening up the building, and so forth versus going up there?
And that's a good question. The new system up there, the HVAC system, it's got individual units in all of the rooms, so those rooms would be locked off at night, so we wouldn't be heating, doing any different with those rooms, all of the individual rooms. Really, the only different, you'd have to heat the courtroom or cool the courtroom for the meetings. I mean, it's already cooled to a certain level. You may just have to cool it a little bit more for your meetings or heat it, depending on which time of the year it is. And then the restrooms that are in the basement, those would have to be where either turned down or up during that time. So I don't know that the cost you're talking about, probably 3 hours a meeting night, you know, so 6 hours a month, so 70-some hours a year probably. So it wouldn't be, I don't know that the cost would be extravagant to be able to heat and cool a building that additional time.
Decide not to do it or to do it,
Yes, I don't know that. And then you know, we won't have people coming in and out of this building too, so, you know, we won't be using this building those
nights.
You've got
to shut this one up and then go up there and open that one up, right?
That's right. Well, when we close down at, you know, at 5 or whatever, we'd leave, and then when we come back for the meetings.
Well, what about the logistics of what Tori and Clyde and you and Craig and Amy, as far as getting your material from here to there? It's not as easy as coming out of Craig's office.
That's correct. Now, we do have one room up there where actually the equipment would be housed. Is some of this stuff could be stored in that room. We will have to rearrange the courtroom, but we bought the furniture in a way in which we use existing furniture in the courtroom for the most part. Other than we have to roll some chairs in from an adjacent room, but we bought the equipment, so we use it, the furniture used for court proceedings, we actually use it for the Board of Commissioners meetings also. So it's probably a 15-minute setup time for the room. I'd have to let them answer as to how much difficulty it'd be for them carrying their stuff up there, you know, for the meetings, their items.
Most everything that I need, as long as I can have access to a printer or my computer here, it wouldn't be that big a deal.
Well, here's my concern and the feedback that I've gotten. I think we want to be as open and encourage citizens to come to these meetings. I really do. And I have talked to people and have received feedback that people sometimes don't come because they don't want to be relegated to the back room and watch on a screen what they could watch online the next day or on television, whatever. So from that standpoint, I think it's important that we consider a larger room. Now, if the larger room's the new courthouse, great, or the new old courthouse. The second thing, even the way that the speakers stand, we can see you plainly, but your audience can't see you. And if we had room where the speaker could be, where everybody could see them in terms of the configuration, I think that might be better.
And one thing that, because we were up at the other day, and we haven't worked through these details, but I was up there the other day, and one thing that occurred is that when a PowerPoint presentation is not going on, whether or not the screen could actually project the board on it or the speaker on it on the screen, so that the audience could either look at the screen or they could be looking at what's going on with the board. You know what I'm saying? So that those that may not be able to, maybe to the back of the speaker, if they looked up on the screen, they may actually see the speaker's face, right, because the cameras are actually, I don't know whether we can do that, but no, that's maybe an option.
But moving the speaker to where
Put a side stand, and that
would be the mic system for the speaker stand is a cordless mic, so we can put it anywhere. You can move around. So there's some options there.
And I guess the final point or question, I'd like to know maybe the capacity of this room plus that room. Just that room versus what we're seeing at the new old courthouse.
Now, I can give you those numbers. This room itself has a capacity of 50 individuals. That's including board members, staff, everybody. 50 people in here. The one adjacent to it is 135. So that's a total of 185. the courtroom up there downstairs has a capacity of 168. That's including everybody.
Downstairs
there has a capacity of 168, and the upstairs balcony has a capacity of 81. So it's got a total of 249 in that building, and we have a total of 185 here. So you pick up 64 seats there.
Plus everybody's in the same room.
In the same room.
Now, if I know we haven't really explored that, but is it a possibility to do this bigger room as our meeting room?
We've used it for budget meetings. What you'd have to do then is relocate all of the cameras over there, so you're going to incur that. Not to say you couldn't, but that's what you'd have to do to move it over there.
That's still 135 people. I don't think we have many more than that at any meeting.
But we could.
Yeah, we could.
But we could have more than 249, too.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think we will, but we could. I mean, I think everybody's heard those complaints, not just
right.
Mr. Manning.
Yeah.
We've all heard they don't like to go in the other room.
Yeah, and the microphone system, these are not for amplification in here. These are actually for the recording device.
Mm-hmm.
The microphones, and I have to verify this, but the microphones in there's a very nice sound system in the courtroom to where when the judge is speaking or the attorneys are speaking, you'll hear it all over the courtroom. Our system, I would anticipate, would be tied in that same thing, that when you're speaking, not only is it amplifying it for the room, but it's also recording it for production. So it's doing both of those
things. How many people we got in the other room right now?
I don't know. Dave Leonard may be over there. Hopefully Dave will come over here in just a minute and tell us that.
He'll know.
So maybe Dave is on his way.
Nine. They're all county.
Right.
All the county, will all the county employees in here stand up if you don't mind, or raise your hand? Well, I'm sorry. I'm going to vote to save $23,000. I have been in it. I've been, you know, and I'm kind of sentimental. I ain't going to lie to you. I'm a little sentimental. I've been sitting here 17 years, too long for a lot of people. I do think there should be some reverence to seniority in a way. I wouldn't dare go to the Rotary Club and try to move where they eat lunch as soon as I hit their dining room. And that might, I mean that a little tongue-in-cheek. But we've never had to move a meeting from here that I remember. One night we moved over next door. And it was a budget meeting, and it was so many people coming up the steps, they said, we ain't going to be able to have it in here. We all ran to the courthouse. I mean, literally ran up there. And they opened up the balcony, they hadn't cleaned it, and it was dusty, dirty as heck. And then one night we've met over there a couple of times for extenuating circumstances. And then we went to Williams High School for a budget reevaluation vote cycle back, not this past cycle, but cycle back. And I think we had the last reevaluation vote at the courthouse, if I'm not mistaken, or somewhere, I don't know. But bottom line is, again, if you just look at the numbers, if the county employees would meet over there, I mean, just get over there and meet, there'd be enough room for the public, in my opinion. The public, general public. And the county employees aren't really here to speak except for when asked, you know, we want information from them. And you say you got nine over there right now. This is a good example. I think this is more than an average meeting right now, in my opinion. We meet, what, 24 times a year, right, roughly? Well, we don't even meet that many times. Cancel a couple.
Right.
This is more than we have, way more than average for a normal meeting. And if you factor out, you said nine over there?
Yes, sir. Mr. Sutton, if I can kind of address that a little bit. As we were asked to, the fire marshal's office was asked to, you know, make sure that we did not fill the capacity up in this room. All of the department heads and any department personnel that attend these meetings, they are asked to sit in the overflow room. And as we near the 7 o'clock hour for the, the beginning of this meeting, if we see that there are additional seats in here, I will go over and try to encourage anyone that would like to come in here and sit too as well. So tonight we were only at 42 in this room for tonight's event, and the other nine I went in and asked if anyone wanted to come, and they chose just to stay in there.
How many people, the general public, though, I'm trying to get at, is in here right now? But none next door, right?
Yes, sir. None next door.
How many is general public tonight? Raise your hand. How many is that?
General public, one, two, three, four, six,
what, 11, 12 people, right?
Yeah,
I just can't vote to spend $23,000 for what I think that's the average number you're going to get, except for extenuating circumstances. That's my personal opinion.
Okay. Any other comments about it? I mean, are we supposedly going to vote on this tonight?
We were just asked to bring the information back.
We'd like to explore the possibility of that, using that road, maybe. I mean, have we even thought of that?
Well, that's primarily set up as a courtroom. I know when we used it before, it was basically setting up temporary tables in there for the meeting. So it was, I guess the members that were on the board at that time could maybe speak as to how well it worked for a commissioner's meeting.
I mean, on those special meetings where you got,
One of the problems is that if you move them over there, we don't have the camera system set up to be able to record the meetings over there. What we did in the past, I think we record them with a single camera that does the best it can, but it's not to the quality of what you have in here. So if you did move it over there, we would need to relocate all the cameras over there and do that. So, and that's, I mean, that is a possibility. You know,
I mean, it may be a bigger savings than going to the old courthouse.
So are you asking that we...
I would like to postpone the vote on it to just explore that.
Can you get those estimates?
On relocating over to the other room? Yes, sir, we could do that.
Sure.
And then whatever setup we would need over there that's more of a permanent-looking nature for a board meeting that looks appropriate, we could try to get some numbers on that, too.
Okay. How's everybody feeling?
That's fine with me.
And that's 135?
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. That's correct.
It's 135 in there.
That's 135. Then that's correct.
You could flip-flop and do if you
Well,
had
I just think it would be easier
crowd.
To have everybody in the same room mm-hmm. where everybody hears the same conversation without looking at it on a monitor. You know, treat everybody the same.
Very seldom have we ever had 135 people.
Well, again, I think tonight's a darn good example. If you took all the county, I mean, I don't think we're really too worried about county employees, department heads, forgive me, having to watch it on screen. Oh, that's a big deal. But I think this is a good example tonight. It's an average meeting, more than average. You only got 11 or 12 people here. And I think that's just, again, $23,000 to accommodate. No offense. I'm going to say this. I know I get in trouble for everything I say. But this thing has been on a rail for literally a year to put it up there. It's been on a rail with certain people. Management, I think there's been certain lobbying efforts going on with certain commissioners. Frankly, as a commissioner, I didn't like the way that this whole process came down. But I stand by my numbers here of what we've been able to point out tonight with stand-ups and what's over there and the dollars. I stand on my decision. Now, I would entertain going over there.
I think it would be simple to look at.
But I'm willing to be outvoted on it, but that's just the way I feel about it.
We'll just have a motion to postpone.
We'll postpone.
Until we get some more information.
See if we can get some more numbers.
Do I hear a
second? Do we need a motion, or do we just table it?
He's making it.
Get some numbers until that.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, it's no rush. We got time.
Okay. Y'all like numbers to move it next door?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, we'll be glad to get those together.
That option.
Okay, all right. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. All right, next is discussion of the sale of real property by seal bid located at 717 North Park Avenue. Clyde Albright, there you are.
Hello. I think I've got a map on the screen up here that shows the two parcels. They were purchased by the county in 1988, I think. To run what was then called the Shelter Workshop. The building was built in 1922, so it's almost 80 years old. And you can see the roof on the back side of it.
Can I ask you a question about the roof now? You alluded to the roof. That's the first thing I noticed. The roof on the right part, is that a lot newer than what's on the left? Yeah,
I couldn't find any information on this.
It is. It's got to be. I mean, it's almost, there's not even a...
That was a textile plant before we bought it.
How new is that right side roof?
I don't know an actual date, but that whole section, not just the roof, but that whole section of building was added at a much later date than the original construction.
On the right portion.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah.
I couldn't find anything in our minutes from 1988 other than we bought it.
Yeah, I was raised up in that neighborhood, so I know.
I do know the tax value on it is $786,390 on the building, and then on the parking lot, $59,793.
That parking lot's across the street?
Yes.
On the right-hand side?
I went out there and looked at it. It's in pretty bad shape, but I'm not going to tell you how much it would cost to repair it. I think these folks here have probably got an idea about it, but I was asked to explore the possibility of selling it to them in a private sale. So that's what we did. We set it up for a public hearing. It was a private sale. By its very nature, it's a private sale. So this board told us to set up at a public hearing. I started working with Tom Steele, the attorney for O&E, and we soon got word from the bank that they were not going to agree to a reverter clause. Now, a private sale under the statute requires a reverter clause. So that if it ceases to be used for nonprofit uses, it comes back to the county. The bank wouldn't finance it that way. So that's why we began discussions with the other four methods of sale. Allowed by statute, you can have advertisement for sealed bid, negotiated offer, advertisement, and upset bid. You can have a public auction, or you can have an exchange of property. And all of those are advertised in the paper for the statutorily required time, so there's nothing being hidden there. But the problem with this property is it's so old, and it has not been maintained, and it's going to take a lot of money to bring it up to standards. So it's really up to the board to decide which way you want to go with this. Tom and I have talked about it, how we could make this work, and I'm glad to have him come up and tell you what he's learned from the bank. But really, I think the only way to do it is this sealed bid, in my opinion.
What's it insured for?
Well, we've got it on our...
not tax... insurance.
We've got it on our, I think, our blanket coverage for buildings. I don't think there's a specific insurance policy on that building.
So there's like I say, I couldn't find value given to it.
Well, just the tax value is the only thing I've got on it. Like I say, I couldn't find anything.
What is the tax value of that building?
The building itself is $786,390. That's the assessed value. Of course, you've got to find somebody willing to buy it.
Yeah,
and put a new roof on it. It's a 75,000 square foot building, so that's pretty hefty roof cost.
I thought we had somebody
paying rent right now.
Pardon?
Is OE paying rent right now?
We have an interest.
We looked into it, and we found out they were in it. I don't think we even have an agreement with them. I think the way this came about was the LME back in 1988, mm-hmm. purchased, or had the county purchase this property for the sheltered workshop. And it's been used in that capacity ever since. And the OME folks are here. I'm not exactly sure how they got involved in it, but they have been running it and quite successfully helping people with developmental and physical disabilities make some money and earn a living. And they're willing to borrow the money on it and redo the heating and air conditioning system. Of course, they've got to, I guess they're going to have to look at making it ADA compliant if it's not compliant, and maybe upgrading wiring and plumbing. It just has it's an 80-year-old building. It's got a lot of problems. So those are our choices. Unless the county wants to spend the money and renovate it, that's another option.
Mm-mm. Well, you and I talked about just as an option, mm-hmm. getting a loan for them and them paying it back. We don't give it to them, but I mean, just like we did, didn't we do the airport authority the same way? Or same
thing? We loaned it to their former.
We loaned it to them, got a loan.
We loaned it to them.
Okay. And theoretically, just hypothetically, can we get a loan for them?
$300,000, if we leased it to them for 10 years, they'd have to pay us about $3,000 some odd dollars a month to pay that back. And I don't think they have that cash flow. I don't know.
That's always an option. I'd hate to take another hit to our fund balance right now.
I would either.
But we could always borrow money against it, you know, and have them pay the debt service. You know, that would be the lease payment. That's probably an option. We also talked about an option of maybe having first option on the build. You know, if they ever decide to sell it, is maybe that would work. That if they decide to leave 5, 6, 7 years down the road, we purchase it from them for whatever the outstanding amount is on the loan. If it's $1 million, the option may be no, but you know that it
that
may be an option.
That would assure us to get it back,
right? Or at least have the option. So there's a couple of ways to skin the cat.
Let me ask you a question, Tom. Maybe your client can respond to this. I talked to the folks from the LME because they had some concerns about the services. You know, we're talking about the ownership of the building, which is important. You know, Alamance County taxpayers, we want to get rid of a piece of property. But we also are concerned about the provision of services in that building. And the individual I talked to, who I guess maybe had talked to you, but there was not a reverter clause, but there's apparently...
He's been involved in some meetings with folks from the ARC and from the LME.
Well, my question is there apparently a state statute that says because you're a not-profit that if you did vacate the premises, it would have to go or the services would have to still be transferred to another nonprofit?
Yes, sir. It's in state statute. It's also specifically stated in our articles of incorporation as a 501c3 not-for-profit.
Okay.
I have those. If you'd like to see that clause in our articles.
Well, I guess my question is, in explaining that to the representatives of the LME and the ARC, are they now satisfied? And we
yes,
do have
sir.
Somebody from the LME, and I'd just be interested in knowing if there's been any further discussion about that.
Yeah, I apologize for not being at the last meeting, but I did watch the video and saw the exchange between you and Roger Francis, who is our CFO, was at the last meeting. And Roger and I met with Margaret Livengood from the ARC the following week. We also met with Deborah Welch from the LME, and both left satisfied that, you know, the services would continue, whether it would be under OE or under whoever the next provider that came in and took over if we, for some reason, were no longer there.
But it wouldn't necessarily be in that building if you sold the building. I mean, is that right?
If we were to dissolve for any reason, any real property that we own would have to be transferred to another not-for-profit or a government entity. We could not take the property with us, basically.
Okay.
And that's...
I'm sure if you don't mind me...
No, that's fine.
...recognizing
it. I know.
Yeah, last I spoke with Deborah, she's agreed. You know, really, we're more worried about the service and make sure that type of service is there for this community. So we're satisfied with that.
Thank you.
And that is fully our intent. We, as Roger mentioned at the previous meeting, we've been in this business for over 20, approaching 30 years, and for 6 years now in Alamance County since we took over services from Vocational Trades of Alamance.
Well, and you want to talk about that because the provisions of the providers and LME basically encouraged the LME to outsource.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Actually, it was a change in state law. The LMEs had to divest themselves of direct service provision and take over an oversight role versus a direct service provision role. It's also a kind of a vagary of state law and how the county ended up owning the building in 1988 to begin with, because the LME, under state statute, could not own property. So while proceeds from the program from Vocational Trades of Alamance paid the mortgage, the county had to take title of the building because Vocational Trades of Alamance was a part of the LME. So it's not a situation where the county funds were used to buy a building for VTA. Funds generated from the program at VTA bought the building, but it had to be titled to the county because of that general statute language.
So are you saying here we can privately sell this building to them?
I don't think we can because of the reverter clause.
Oh, okay. So we're going to have to advertise for sealed bids.
Sealed bid advertisement.
But could we not do, as Craig said, put a right first right of refusal should they, whoever buys, sells? I mean.
Well, you're wanting to buy it, right?
Right.
Your group is.
They want to make the improvements.
But if it's sealed bid, I mean, you know, it could come in, somebody else make an offer, too.
Well, I don't think we better get our hopes up for a real high price because if they buy the building for X and then have to spend $300,000 on a building that was built in 1920, whatever.
And that $300,000 figure, that includes HVACs, a modification to the entrance to make it ADA compliant, some modifications to some lighting and wiring for the general work floor, and that's probably all that's going to cover. And we've had the roof examined by a roofing contractor. We've had some patchwork repairs done by that contractor. And in another 5 to 10 years, that building's going to require a roof. And you're going to hit a half.
It looks like it.
You're going to hit a half million dollars easy.
So why do you want it?
It needs to be repaired, and unless we own it, we can't put $300,000.
Oh, I understand that.
Understand that part.
Yeah, it's.
So I guess at this point, what we need to do is to vote to
put it out as a seal bid.
Out for seal bids.
Just give us some direction which way you want to go with it.
Well, how many of us have been in the building?
On this board. I have.
You been?
I've been over there.
Commissioner Boswell was that reason.
I've been in the front office because I had a friend that worked there when they made socks.
Tom gave me a nice tour of it, and they really do a great job. They do some foam stuff for a couple companies, and these guys, they're really got a good program going there.
Now, there is some, I guess, records stored on the second floor that will have to be moved? Or?
There are records that belong to the LME that are stored on the second floor, and you know they're locked, and we don't even have access to that portion. It's theirs.
Well, Ms. Wells had indicated that they could either be moved or maybe even destroyed based on their age.
We're working with PBH to determine what we need to do with the records. Yeah.
So they'll be out.
The best thing would be to remove it from that site. Yes.
But my conversation with her was along the same lines that they're most of them are of an age where they need to be destroyed.
And is there a comment from you or Tom Steele about what the bank has indicated, or would you prefer not to reveal that?
Well, no, we don't have anything to hide about that. I have not had an opportunity to speak directly to the bank about this possibility of a right of first refusal. They did indicate to me very clearly they would not accept a possibility of reverter because we could not get title insurance coverage over that. They wanted to have a first lien. And to know that in the event they foreclose, that whoever might bid would buy free and clear without having to worry about the county's reverter rights.
Well, that makes sense.
They may feel the same way about a possibility of a right of first refusal. I don't know. Now, they did talk preliminarily with Roger today and indicated to him they thought they'd be okay. But with all due respect, I would like to speak to them and be sure of that before we made a final decision about that, because sometimes when an attorney has a conversation and explains fully what something means to someone and they hadn't fully understood it before, their decision changes. So I would just like the opportunity to make that clarification, if I could, with the bank before we went off
saying
that we would be
this.
Comfortable with a right of first refusal.
Okay.
Now,
added to this advertisement for sale.
Right.
Bids.
But the right of first refusal would be back to the county to buy the property.
Right.
And
right.
We would buy it for at least the amount of the loan.
Whatever they had
right.
Paid
whatever
us.
Whatever loans that were on it at the time.
Right.
We
right.
exercised.
Right.
There may
right.
be more than.
And so we may not want it then.
Right.
And actually, how much do we get out of this property?
Not anything.
So,
not a thing.
Okay, so we're talking from zero to something then.
Really, what the county gets out of it is providing a public service.
Exactly. We're providing a service is what we're doing.
Both a public service to the individuals that we serve and also a public service to the businesses that we partner with and produce products for.
I don't think there's any question about that.
Oh, I don't doubt that part.
Tom, let me just ask you this.
Yes, sir.
Have you looked at what alternatives you might have? Like, let's say you didn't want that and you had to move. Is there other property that's suitable for your needs?
We have looked at other properties. We have not found one that's suitable. We actually looked at the property across the street that used to be Golto. It's much larger than our needs, and it would require a substantial upfront investment for ADA compliance itself. So,
oh, it's huge.
It's 250-odd thousand square feet on three levels.
Most of that whole block.
Yeah. Most of your clients are handicapped. And the people that work there are in wheelchairs.
Many of them use wheelchairs or walkers or have mobility issues that would prevent them from utilizing stairs. So a multi-level structure like that would be, it would be cost prohibitive to.
Well, I guess we can go ahead and vote to put it out for bid, and then you can check on yours.
Right. Madam Chair, I would just ask that if you, if I think that we would be comfortable with the idea of a sealed bid process, okay, if there were not going to be, if we knew that there were not going to be a requirement of
first refusal
there. If that's something that the board would feel strongly that they would want to have, I think I would ask that you defer your vote
until you find out.
Clarify that point, because obviously, if we can't get the bank loan, we can't move forward.
Yeah. Exactly.
But isn't another question based on your sealed bid amount plus the cost of improvements? You may not be able to get an appraisal to justify that value, in which case you couldn't get the bank loan anyway.
That's correct. An appraisal has been ordered and still has not been received, to my knowledge, has it?
It has.
It has. We have.
Okay. Okay.
So you're going to incorporate that value in your bid. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, I know you guys want to move forward, but I don't see that as that urgent that we cannot.
With the vote tonight, they're not.
Okay. Give Tom time to check on it.
Whatever.
So are we going to ask for a right of first refusal?
Greg? I'm not sure if that's something the bank will agree to. And you know,
well, that's what
require
it, that's
then
what
they don't know if they'd be able to meet that requirement.
Madam Chair, my understanding from Mr. Albright was that the statutes do not require the board to impose that obligation. So I think it's up to the board to decide if I understood Mr. Albright.
That's correct.
Correct. Okay.
Well, I don't have a problem with not requiring that option as long as the services by law have to be provided. That's the number one concern that I heard from people that I talked to. I think the first, we may not have the first option, but if we want the property back, we can always put in a bid to buy it back anyway. I don't really think we would, but if we get the price that is consistent with what the appraised value is, considering the renovations that you're going to put into place, then, I mean, I think we've done due diligence and done our homework.
And of course, the sealed bids would be opened by the county and presented to the board.
Right.
So you can refuse.
Right.
A bid.
Okay.
Well,
we have to go with the highest if we decide to sell.
The highest, most responsible.
Mm-hmm.
Which is not the highest.
Well, I think you could make that choice at the time. You can reject them all if you want to reject them all. If the highest bid is $10, you can certainly reject. Mm-hmm. Reject them all.
Okay. Well, if that's the case, I guess I can entertain a motion then to advertise for sealed bids. Is that all right with you, Tom?
Yes, ma'am.
Well, I'll make that motion.
All right. Have a motion. I need a second.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
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 What's the time frame on the bids?
We have to advertise.
Sure.
Let's put it in the paper, advertise it.
Okay.
Just curious. I had the resolution right in front of me. I can't see it, but
my hands on it. That's okay. You know.
Okay.
But we have to follow the statutory requirements under...
That's okay. I'm all right.
All right, next is county manager reports.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just a couple of announcements on dates. Just a reminder, we will be moving our Labor Day meeting from that Monday, September 5th, to Tuesday, September 6th. So that's on our schedule. To re-remind you of the courthouse grand opening, which will be September 10th at 10 a.m., please make sure you have that on your calendar. Also, the city-county dinner will be hosted by Elon on August 18th at 6 o'clock at Beth Smith Park. So if you're interested in going, please let Tori know. And I will begin my vacation in about 15 minutes. And so I will be gone the rest of the week, and I will be back Monday if you didn't.
We need to have a longer meeting tonight, folks.
I think we got something else we need to talk about.
Okay. In.
That was a half a day.
You don't think he's like Obama, plays on vacation all the time? He flies that plane everywhere.
Let's don't take that, please. Any more?
I'm good.
Okay. Next is our consent agenda, tax refunds and releases, and approval of April 18th closed session minutes and regular meeting. Do I hear a motion to accept the consent
I'll
agenda?
I'll make a motion that we accept it.
Second.
Okay. And a motion and second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Next, then, we go to the commissioner's comments.
Yeah, I want to bring up something. Is anybody from the landfill here tonight?
I don't think Greg
is.
Okay, I just want to leave this with the county manager and see if we can get some commentary from him.
I'm looking.
Ms. Carter at Mevin Enterprise, she mentioned to me on the telephone the other day about Davidson County's landfill has gone high-tech, and big article here about Catawba County's, the headline on Greensboro News and Record Sunday was the landfill of the future, and I'm not saying I support this, I just want to know what's the difference between ours and theirs, Davidson, and this one, Catawba, and what kind of money flow would be required to do the same or equalize or whatever.
All right. We're already up there.
Any other commissioners' comments?
I do have I did go to the graduation of the Junior Police Academy, so we do have another plaque that was presented to Alamance County Commissioners. So that was a lot of fun. It was 33, I think it was, that graduated that night, and they were very, very elaborate when they were called upon and really did a great job. So I just want everybody to know that I did go to this this past week. And also, Mr. Bakatosh catered it, and it was great food at Ramada. That's it. Anything else? We got any announcements? If not, we are adjourned.
Yes, see you.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 1-